Members, this is the appointed time and we have a quorum. The administration is here with us. Let me just go through a number of points. This is a regular meeting of the panel on welfare services. Members, as you know, we have a regular schedule. We usually have meetings at 10:45 in the morning. And we have always been able to extend the meeting by 15 or 30 minutes. We have quite a relaxed schedule, but for some reason, we're only able to book this room at 2:30 today. We have another meeting following this, so I will need members to observe the speaking time limits more rigorously. We have three information papers issued since the last meeting. One is a joint letter from Dr. Chi-yuen and Ms. Lillian KWOK requesting the panel to discuss implementing community emotional counseling services as early as possible. The administration has indicated that they have noted this request. The second paper is a referral from a public complaints office regarding the pilot scheme on community care service voucher for the elderly. The third paper is an information paper entitled One-off Extra Allowance for Recipients of Social Security Payments and Working Family Allowance Provided by the Administration. We're not going to discuss these information papers. The next regular meeting is scheduled for 10:45 a.m. Monday on the 8th of May. We have two items for discussion next time. One is subsidizing training programs for professionals providing healthcare services in residential care homes. I understand that this is related to the qualifications framework and the progression pathway. Second item, review of skill and qualification requirements of residential care home staff. Any views, members, in relation to these two items and other suggestions for the next meeting? Dr. Tik Chi-yuen, anyone else? Yes, 1 minute for Dr. Tik. I don't have strong views on the two proposed items, but I have this question about the second item, about skill and qualification requirements of staff. Now, I see that we have both the health worker and rehabilitation workers. What ranks and grades are involved? Are nurses and other grade staff involved? We need to make sure there is clarity. There is a prevailing manpower shortage at the moment. So I'd like to know more about the delineation, and I'd like to discuss all the relevant staff. Other members, any views on the items to be discussed at the next meeting? Now, as chair, my response is follows. I don't need the administration to reply to that because we are not discussing this item at this meeting. But please note what Dr. Tik said and what he is requesting for. The second point is that would the administration please note that the sector is concerned about the prevailing manpower crunch in both subvented sector, subsidized and private sectors. So please take note of his request, and I will relay Dr. Tik's message to the Labour and Welfare Bureau as well. Next item, review of residential child care services. I think members must have had this paper with you. Ms. Charmaine Lee, Director of Social Welfare, has led a review conducted by the committee. The second phase review has now been completed. Director Ms. Charmaine Lee will walk us through the paper. We have until 3:30 to discuss this item, but I suppose members will have a lot to say on residential child care services. I'm going to draw a line as soon as the director has completed her presentation. Members, if you want to speak, please press the button as quickly as possible. Ms. Lee. Thank you, Chairman. Chairman, members, good afternoon. I'd like to brief members on the second phase review of the residential child care and related services. In April last year, the Committee on Review of Residential Child Care and Related Services was set up by the Social Welfare Department. A review was conducted in two phases on residential child care and related services in order to make recommendations. The first phase review was completed in August 2022, covering residential child care centers and residential special child care centers for children aged under six. In October last year, we briefed the members on the outcome of the first phase review. 31 recommendations were made in the first phase. We are following up on these recommendations. I will now give you an introduction of the second phase review. The second phase review was commenced in September 2022, which covered children's homes, boys' girls' homes, boys' girls' hostels, and non-institution services, including foster care service, small group homes, and small group homes for mildly handicapped children. The review was completed in March 2023. Some 39 recommendations have been made. These are set out in Annex 9. I'm not going to go through the recommendations one by one, but all in all, there are recommendations on three areas in terms of service quality, service planning, and monitoring. In general, the recommendations include increasing manpower, providing strengthened professional support, enhanced training for staff, enhancement to the monitoring mechanism and indicators, and providing strengthened support for discharges and flexible deployment of residential care places. On foster care services, there are recommendations on introduction of flexibility in terms of recruitment and retaining foster parents, stepping up publicity. There is also a suggestion to review the incentive payment system. I'd like to thank the review committee for their invaluable input. The administration will actively follow up on the recommendations. If additional resources are required, we will follow the established mechanism to seek funding support to implement the relevant improvement measures. My team and myself will be happy to receive comments and questions from members. Thank you. Now, before the meeting, with the help of Dr. Chi-yuen, a group of child care service operators met with members to share their views and feelings on their work. I don't think we'll be able to cover the ground in just a few minutes accurately. So I intend to do the following. Perhaps we should conduct a public hearing in due course. I'd like to invite the administration to attend as well. There are altogether 70 recommendations in the review report. And if by then the administration can give us an interim report, it would be the best. So members, if you haven't pressed the button and if you want to speak, please do so now. I'm going to draw a line here. Let me read out the names of members. Mr. Stanley Lee, Mr. Lok Chung Hong, Mr. Kenneth Leung, Mr. Chan Pui Leung, Mr. Michael Tian, Reverend Peter Kuhn, Dr. Tik Chi Yun, Ms. Lillian KWOK, and myself. All right. No other members would like to speak, right? I'll draw a line here. I'll give each member 5 minutes. Questions and answers included, please. We start with Mr. Stanley Lee. Thank you, Chair. Last year, there were some unfortunate incidents relating to residential child care services. With the efforts made by the administration and through the review committee, some recommendations have been put forward. I acknowledge their effort. Now, I understand from the report that there are recommendations relating to the first phase review as well, including stepping up the mechanism, improving the mechanism, and stepping up monitoring of the services. First, on manpower, we all acknowledge the manpower crunch at the moment. In the social welfare sector, Our staff have more on their plate because of the manpower squeeze, leading to some unfortunate incidents. There are a number of recommendations on strengthening manpower deployment, providing professional support, and strengthening training. But the fundamental problem is recruitment difficulty. So with the severe manpower shortage, how are you going to implement the recommendations in these three areas? Second question, some children come from a rather complicated background. From information, I understand that some 40 to 60% of users come with special needs, and some have left the services and are living independently. That accounts for 53% upon discharge. So is there a mechanism to keep in keep them in reach, to follow up on their cases, to make sure that they are integrated into society after leaving the institutions? Thank you, Chair. Let me take the two questions. On manpower, there are two phases. In the first phase review, we looked at the severe manpower shortage, and we also recommend strengthening manpower. And if you recall, in the first phase, there are recommendations on improving the manpower ratio and increasing the number of frontline staff. But that was what happened during the first phase review. At the time, we didn't manage to strive for resources. But I'm happy to report to members that starting in financial year 2023-24, some $56.7 million will be made available to implement the enhancement to manpower measures in first phase of the review. Now, as set out in the report regarding the second phase review, there are recommendations on increasing the manpower of the assistant social work officer, frontline care workers such as welfare workers, social welfare assistants, and also health workers, clerical assistants, and workmen too. As set out in the report, the review committee has recommended increasing manpower for these positions. So we will follow the established internal mechanism to strive for resources to implement the recommendations. Another point on manpower is to strengthen training. Our recommendation is to groom new talents to join the social welfare sector. That is why we recommend that tertiary institutions offering social work training to cooperate with NGOs so as to arrange for fieldwork placements and voluntary work for students to get a better idea of the residential childcare services. The other aspect is about children with special needs. In fact, we have additional resources for clinical psychologists to provide on-site services in the care homes. When they are required to leave, when children are required to leave the institutions, we also hope to enhance professional support for them upon their discharge. Mr. Lok Chung Hong. Thank you, Chair. Well, Ms. Sammy Chang won the Best Actress Award in this film about foster care. There have been wide repercussions in society, and I think that many families are inspired to become to provide foster care. And that's the movie called Lost Love about foster care. Now, I have a question on enhancing incentive payments. The rate now stands at $4,800 plus, and also another sum called the living supplement, $6,500. What will be the criteria adopted for reviewing the incentive payments? Now, about those living in public housing units in general, the living space is not as big, but then these families are devoted to providing care for children. I wonder if it is possible to do this. Say we have parents committed to providing foster care for children on a long-term basis. Is it possible for them to get a bigger flat under the PRH allocation mechanism? Are there measures to help them get more space? Because be it residential care or otherwise, if we have a family-based foster care for a child, it will be more conducive to the children's development. Another question is on waiting time. The average waiting time is 1.7 months. The utilization rate, however, only stands at some 80%. Now, why must an applicant wait for 1.7 months? We're talking about some 6 or 7 weeks. If the utilization rate is as low as 81%, not even 90%, why do we have a long waiting time for applicants? And according to the information, the figure is only applicable to cases that can be matched within 3 months. What about cases that cannot be matched within 3 months? What are the difficulties? Director, thank you. Three questions. First, on incentive payment. Just then, Mr. Lucas told us the amount of the incentive payment, but actually, there is a recommendation in the report suggesting a review or an increase of incentive payment. But right now, we cannot give you a concrete figure on the increase because it depends on how many resources we will be able to get. Second, on public housing units, it is true that there are many foster parents living in public rental housing estates. We want to promote foster care service because we want children to be able to receive care in a family setting. And there are indeed many foster parents who live in PRH estates. But our eventual goal is for the children to return to their original family. So this is not supposed to be a long-term arrangement. So if we are to provide alternative living arrangement for them, that would be challenging. But we will be looking into a deduction system of the incentive payment. Right now, the incentive payment is tax exempted, but they have to declare the incentive payment as income to the housing authority. So it is recommended to explore with the housing authority if the incentive payments for foster parents can be exempted from declaration. As for the waiting time for foster care, to my understanding, it is because of the matching situation. Perhaps I'll invite Assistant Director to tell us more. If there is a place available, then we will select an appropriate child to match with the foster family. But in the interim, it may cause a drop in the utilization rate. But the turnover rate is constant, and we endeavor to arrange services as soon as possible to minimize the gap. Thank you. Next, Mr. Kenneth Lung. Thank you. I'm happy to see all these recommendations raised. In paragraph 9 of the paper, for children who reunited with their families or live independently after leaving the services,
are about 70% and 53% respectively. As for the follow-up services, Mr. Stanley Lee has just inquired. I don't believe the administration has given us an answer. Do you provide any assistance in terms of employment or education, etc.? Can you tell us more? And in Annex 9, Item 25, it is recommended to explore the feasibility of lowering the admission age to provide those with various special needs or severe emotional and behavioral problems with suitable services, and to explore the feasibility of reducing the age range of users of small group homes and to cater for their developmental needs. So how are you going to cater to their different needs? Director. Regarding the discharge support, it is suggested in our report that we will enhance the function of caseworkers. We find that for any individual case, many social workers are involved. They may be social workers from school, from institutions, or from social welfare department. So how are we going to consolidate and utilize these resources? We will appoint a case manager. One of their responsibilities is to enhance discharge support. That means a welfare plan has to be set up for the child during their stay in the institution, and they have to formulate a long-term plan to see whether or not they will return to their original family or whether they will live independently after leaving the institution. If it is decided that the child will live independently after discharge, then they need to arrange support services for this young person after discharge. This can be provided by the social welfare department and other social welfare organizations or community organizations. The other question is on recommendation 25, flexible deployment of residential care places. Actually, Mr. Leung has struck a chord. It is very difficult to have a very clear cut as to how we can flexibly deploy residential care places. It all has to depend on the circumstances of each child, their past experience, etc. For children who are younger or older, that may affect the situation as well. And just then we talk about there is an increasing number of children with special needs. There may be behavioral or emotional issues. That is why we need to enhance manpower, be it assistance, social work officer, or frontline caregiver. We want to provide the emotional support that children need. That's why in the report, we need to step up professional support from clinical psychologists, etc. Any follow-up? Well, I have a quick follow-up question regarding the application of technology. In the whole paper, you only mentioned better utilization of the website and better data collection. In many of our meetings, we have discussed adopting AI technology in CCTV systems. So have you considered that, Director? In the first phase of the review, we were targeting children age 6 or below. We are now exploring the feasibility of using AI technology. As for the second phase review regarding older children, we also would like to recommend the installation of appropriate monitoring system. Thank you. Next, Mr. Chen Pui Lan. Two questions. In NS6, The average waiting time for the small group home for mildly mentally handicapped children, the waiting time is 15.1 months and your occupancy rate is 98%. This is the number from 2021 to 22. I would like to know whether you have adopted any new measures to shorten the waiting time. This is my first question. Second, the review committee has recommended the development of foster care services. But we can see that in the past 5 years, children waiting for foster care services have been increasing. But the number of foster care families withdrawing from the services has also increased. So has the authority, has the administration considered what the reasons may be and whether there can be any improvement measures? And the number of newly registered foster families has gone down as well. I wonder why that is. And do you have any suitable measures in place to tie in with the recommendation of developing foster care services? Thank you. Firstly, on the waiting time for the small group homes for mildly mentally handicapped children, if you refer to the table, not just for these type of small group homes, for other residential care as well, there is a waiting time. Generally speaking, there is a shortage of placement, service places. Perhaps I'll invite the assistant director to tell us the measures in place to increase the number of service places. We can see that there is an increasing demand. So, in various development projects, be it public rental housing estates or private development, whenever there is appropriate land, we have reserved spaces for children's homes or small group homes. We will keep an eye on any future appropriate site. For foster care services family, you have given us some number. There are 880 children in foster care families, and there are some 900 foster families. So for now, we have enough foster families to take care of children in need of the service. But we would like to promote foster families. Yes, there are some families withdrawing from the scheme. From 2022 to 23, 58 families withdrew from the scheme, but 55 new families joined the scheme. There may be various reasons. They may be leaving Hong Kong, or there are changes in their family circumstances. We have heard views that the incentive payment is too low. It is difficult to support a child using the incentive payment and the allowance. That is why, in the report, it is recommended that a review on the incentive payment should be conducted. More importantly, we want to step up publicity effort and identify target groups. Let's say employees of larger enterprises or people from churches, religious centers, etc. We want these people to participate in the foster care family scheme.
Right, a follow-up question on quotas and the number of places and more places in public housing estates. Do you have an indicator in the short term by how much you will increase the number of places. It seems that starting this year, we have more places already. In fact, last year, we have one additional small group home, and this year, we're going to have one more. So that means altogether 34 more places. Mr. Michael Tian, Annex 9 of the paper, according to the review committee, 5 recommendations on service monitoring have been put forward. One of the recommendations is to install CCTV at suitable locations and also draw up policy mechanism in surveilling and viewing the video records. And then on risk-based principles, when need be, inspections will be stepped up. Well, you need to increase the frequency and you need to ensure effectiveness. It is easy to inspect the shops frequently. It's a different matter what is the subject, what the subject of inspection is. At the welfare panel meeting of the 15th of November last year, I raised this point. I think it is not effective to manually view the video records as a form of inspection. We need to use AI. According to the administration, 2 childcare centers are now using AI, and the administration is liaising with the ASTRI to see how we can better deploy artificial intelligence. Now, if you use AI, the system can flag irregular movements so that you only checked those flagged bits of the record. In fact, this is commonly deployed in other jurisdictions. Is it that for all the childcare centers, you are able to install CCTV with AI? Also, in order to ensure quality, at least once every 6 months, the management should submit management reports to the governing board of the operator. I think it's really going against the grain, at least on my part, for one to regulate a member of the own organization. You should engage an independent unit to do the checking instead of vetting a report that you've prepared on your own. A response from the director, please. Thank you, Mr. Tian, for the suggestion. Mr. Tian has expressed concern about applying technology to step up monitoring. When we last reported to members last year, we reported that the CRH has engaged a team in Hong Kong U to conduct a research and see whether AI can be introduced in the monitoring system. We are now working with Smart Lab. We've introduced this arrangement. From the second half of last year to the beginning of this year, we have met with the tertiary research institutions to get an understanding of the relevant technology used in the private market in terms of surveillance. Some improper behavior or conduct have been revealed in residential child care services in the past, and these include actions such as hitting the head of the children. We have passed on this information through Smart Lab to the organizations concerned for the interested developer to be selected. Do you have a timetable? We hope that by the third quarter of this year, we will be able to brief interested RCCS on the AI system. About internal monitoring, be it the first or the second phase review report, the Social Welfare Department is in charge of oversight of the organizations concerned. But apart from that, we also require the governing boards and management of operators to oversee and monitor the operations as well. As set out in the first phase review report, we have a quality assurance group conducting surprise checks. We're talking about members coming from a nursing background and other professions. The six quality assurance groups already conducted two rounds of surprise inspections. My question is whether you will engage an independent organization to check the reports instead of just asking the management of the organization to or the governing board to of the operator to check the reports. We do require them to check the reports, and when we consider the FSAs, we also have regard to their report. Reverend Canon Peter Kuhn, I thank the administration for publishing the second phase review report. There are so many problems with residential childcare services. The first question is on small group homes. I see that the staffing ratio has improved, but say in Annex 7, there are suggestions that the frontline care staff ratio should be enhanced to 1 to 4 or 1 to 6. I don't see anything mentioned in the recommendations. This is an important point because at present the ratio stands at 1 to 8 or even 1 to 9 if we take emergency places into account as well. Will there be an improvement? I understand that new small group homes will be set up in new public housing estates in the coming year. This is good news for the sector. Now, is there will there be an improvement on staffing ratio, an improvement from 1 to 8 on foster care? If my memory serves me right, one of the foster parents must devote his time in full to take care of the children. But this is rather a difficulty for many families. It seems at the moment we cannot delegate the duty to, say, a foreign domestic helper. There are also other requirements relating to, say, window grills. Is it possible to revise the requirements to keep abreast with the times? Because some may say, if I allow my own child to live in this condition, why should I make a special exception for the child under foster care? I think if you can make these revisions, you'll be able to improve foster care. According to the report, the staffing ratio will be enhanced. I won't repeat this point because we will strengthen manpower for different grades and ranks as a whole. But we're not getting into the nitty-gritty of exactly by how much the the ratio will be increased, because there are different types of institutions and foster care services, including small group homes and also girls and boys homes and hostels. There is no one-size-fits-all ratio for all these services. If we're able to strive for more resources internally to strengthen manpower, we can then proceed to discussing with the sector on adjusting the staffing ratio for different types of services. On foster care, there is no requirement for one of the parents to be a full-time foster parent. Now, there are requirements for foster parents, such as safety requirements, whether the parents can provide a safe home environment. This is essential. Let me invite the assistant director to further explain this point. We do not require either of the foster parents to be a full-time parent. In fact, even a singleton can be a foster parent if they meet all the requirements. Assistant Director, there is a misconception whether if you want to provide care, foster care, you need to be a couple or not. But I think the primary consideration is whether you can provide love and care in a safe home environment for the child. We ask about who is primarily responsible for providing care. In some instances, some parents may say they take care of the child themselves. Some parents, however, may have daytime engagements. They may delegate the duty to a foreign domestic helper, which is an arrangement we find acceptable. On safety, this is of paramount importance. And from time to time, we review the requirements with the relevant organizations, such as window grills, such as whether there is a door for the kitchen. Previously, we did have concern on the matter, but that depends on the age of the child under foster care, whether instead of having a kitchen door, we can just put in a grill to separate the two areas. We will find this acceptable as well. All in all, our concern is the child's safety. Dr. Chi-yuen. Thank you, Chairman. Chairman, through you, I'd like to express my view. I'd like to commend the director and her team. They have been able to complete two phases of the review and come up with two reports with a lot of recommendations that can be implemented. They have not delayed the matter, and they have been able to seek resources for the first phase recommendations. I hope you keep up with the good work in the second phase. You have the working group to look after the elderly, the disabled, and caregivers. I hope that you sustain your effort for these groups as well. Coming back to this paper, there is a recommendation to increase manpower for residential child care. This has always been the request of the sector for so many years. I hope you'll be able to get additional resources. I just want to point out at present, there is a severe recruitment difficulty for residential child care centers. Now, among all the services available, the turnover rate for RCCS is particularly high. All eyes are on the residential child care service. Is there anything you can help them in terms of attracting new blood and retaining staff? The problem is so serious at present. A foster-based approach, well, I've discussed with the sector. I think we need to be clear about the positioning of foster care. At the moment, there is a structural issue. Just to name one example, the reward is called an incentive payment, not remuneration, not wages. We want foster parents to have care and love for the child, and in return, they get an incentive payment. Under the prevailing manpower crunch, is it possible to simply rely on the love of the foster parents to provide care? It's food for thought, because according to the report, publicity is futile. If you are not able to, first of all, attract sufficient manpower, all the talk about training, etc., will be futile if you cannot attract newcomers. So it's a structural issue. The paper is silent on improvement measures in this regard. The other point is this. Again, I discussed with the sector, and I understand there are a lot of operational difficulties. Reverend Kuhn referred to some of them. I hope that we'll continue to discuss with the sector and members on the specifics of these implementations.
Director, thank you. Regarding attracting manpower. I believe that this is an issue faced by all sectors of the community. For childcare services, one of the recommendations is to attract more social workers to join the sector by offering related courses in tertiary education, because childcare services are round the clock. It may take more efforts. This is something that can be done immediately. We don't have to wait for extra resources. We can liaise with tertiary institutions and NGOs to promote the sector further. For childcare workers, they may be facing challenges because of what happened in the past year or two. So we want to enhance the professional image of childcare workers. As for foster care service, you are correct. They are on a voluntary basis. That is why the amount of money given to them is called incentive payment. But we recommend the review of the amount of incentive payment to see if there is room to increase it. Any measures that do not require any additional resources, we are happy to follow up on them. Next, Ms. Lillian Kwok. Thank you. First, Chair, I would like to express my appreciation for your suggestion of having a public hearing so that we can hear from childcare services operators firsthand. And I would also like to appreciate what the director said regarding the difficulty or challenges faced by childcare workers who have to provide 24-hour-a-day childcare. If it is possible, perhaps we can try it ourselves to see what actual challenges we may face. I'm sure we all understand that there is a severe shortage of manpower, but I hope that you can consider this. On one hand, you said that you need to step up support or counselling services. Is it possible for you to include the 7,000 plus graduates of Master of Counselling programs so that they can contribute? And for children with special education needs, there are an increasing number of them, especially for the autism spectrum disorder. Many foster family or from small group homes, people have told me that they have received more children with special education needs. Just then you said that there will be further discussion when more details are available. I would like to know what considerations will you be having? Will the manning ratio be increased further if there are more children with SEN admitted? I would also like to know more about service interface. Let's say between institutions, from nurseries to small group homes or to other institutions. You said that you would step up service interfacing. But in the past, the only interfacing that I saw was the transfer of documents. Will there be any actual case follow-up by social workers so that they can follow a case through? And can the administration provide us with more details regarding children who have been discharged after the age of 18. Whether any follow-up is required for such cases. Director, thank you. On emotional support and counseling services, under the lump sum grant, the subvented organizations are able to flexibly deploy their resources. So if they would like to step up their emotional support services or counseling services, then they can engage such professionals to do so. For children with special needs, yes, they have more needs that we need to take care of other than stepping up manpower. We also recommend enhancing professional support, including support from clinical psychologists, other social workers, and, as suggested in the report, if feasible, we would like to engage services by allied health professionals. This will be of help for children with special needs as well. So other than stepping up their own manpower, they can engage external services to cater for these needs. For service interfacing, we hope that there is a case manager following the case of a child all the way through. And usually they are caseworker from the comprehensive child care center. They will follow up all the way through their transfer to other institutions. As for integration to the community, I have to go back and check, because for our services, they cater for young people age 21 or below. After that, they become adults, and I'm not certain whether or not we have this information on hand. Thank you. Next, Ms. Judy Chen. Thank you, Chen. I would like to express my gratitude to the administration. There are many unhappy incidents over the last few years. For the first phase, there are 31 recommendations. For the second phase, 39 recommendations. Although we are not sure that they are all feasible, but this is certainly a good starting point. For the first phase review, it was announced in September last year. So it has been over 6 months already. To my understanding, some of the measures are already in place. Can you share with us their effectiveness and their results? And for recommendations, there is recommendation to increase the number of clerical assistants and workmen too, to help with the administrative workload. We face a manpower shortage across all sectors. I remember that at the beginning of our discussion, we talked about the fact that there are too many administrative works or duties to be fulfilled. There is no mention of how to minimize such administrative duties by using technology, for example. Third, on promotion. The latest movie, Lost Love, I understand that you have hired theaters to show this movie to foster families as part of your publicity effort. This is commendable, and I believe that you can further step up your publicity efforts. When people go see the movie and they feel touched, they may be encouraged to take a step further. I would like to know more about the timeline for the flexible engagement of foster families. Thank you. On the progress of the first phase review, there are 31 recommendations and some major policies have been implemented. First, for the SWD inspection team, there are nurses and former law enforcement officers working in the inspection team. In the future, there will be an additional nurse and a social worker. And for the internal audit system, we have completed the enhancement and we have established service qualities, service quality committees consisting of community leaders, justice of the peace, etc., to conduct surprise inspections. Six of these committees have been formed and they have conducted surprise inspections. And here I would like to thank Ms. Judy Chan's support for applying to be on the committee. And we have set a supervision period. And within that period, we will monitor the care home's services. And we have also established a code of practice for residential care homes. And there are on-site health, on-site rehabilitation services provided to children as well. And with the additional resources secured, we can enhance the manning ratio, introduce professional support, and increase the number of residential childcare places. As for application of technology and utilization of manpower, other than additional clerical staff to handle administrative duties, in the report, it is also recommended that the use of technology be adopted. They can assist workers in preparing documents required in their daily duties. And we did organize a film screening and a sharing session. It was quite touching, actually. Foster families shared their experience with us. But to my understanding, the screening is coming to an end for this movie. But of course, we will be in touch with the director to see if any arrangements can be done. And we are also in touch with large enterprises to promote foster family. Thank you. So I'm the last to speak. Like Ms. Judy Chan, I'm also part of the review committee. Within the past year, we had a minimum of 10 meetings. I'm not sure if I've missed any. I'll say 10 meetings. That's about it. The professionalism, diversity, and members' willingness to face the problems at hand are very helpful in reaching a conclusion. The origin of this is the serious incident of the children's residential home last year. I wonder if the administration can give us more details regarding these aspects. First, for the CRH incident, are the criminal proceedings completed? How many of them have been convicted? What is the estimated completion time? Second, just then you said that for the Hong Kong Society for the Protection of Children, there is a surveillance period. Do you have a clear guidelines setting out how to implement the surveillance period? How are you going to surveil them in specific details? Third, this incident showed that many subvented organizations have continual government subsidy without a time limit. That was quite a shock to our society. So in the two phases of the review, have you considered setting a time limit for receipt of subsidies? I think that these are questions that our society would like answered to. Thank you.
Thank you, Chair. About children's residential homes, CRH, altogether 34 staff members were involved. That's the information we have. As far as we know, 34 staff members in the childcare service have been prosecuted by the police, 12 of whom have been convicted and sentenced. For the remainder, I am afraid I'm not in a position to comment. It is in sub judice. Now, for the 12 defendants convicted and sentenced, we are going to deregister 7 of them. For the others, we are seeking advice from the Department of Justice. So just to reassure Chairman and members, we do take this matter very seriously. Next, about the surveillance period or monitoring period, the CRH is the first one to be put under this special monitoring list. The original agreement is not termed, but now we have imposed a one-year limit on the service agreement. The period will run from 12 months from September last year to August this year. In the reporting period, we'll continue to monitor the CRH. For example, we have dispatched a team to inspect on-site. We also conduct inspections on a regular basis to ensure that there is improvement on the operation and the governance of the service. Basically, they have revamped the management, and on a three-month cycle, they are required to submit a report. So after being put under special watch in September last year, they have submitted the report in December and then another report in March. We scrutinize the reports in detail. We also attend the premises to conduct inspection. About setting a term for the service agreement, in fact, indeed, for some of the FSAs, they are untermed, but for new FSAs, we do provide a term so that or make it a time defined FSA so that if need be, we can terminate the agreement. That concludes the discussion on the second phase review of the residential child care and related services. My feeling is that members are in general supportive of the conduct of a public hearing in the middle of this year to receive deputations and organizations from the sector. Moving on to item 4, let's invite the administration to come in and walk us through the paper. Item 4, annual briefing by welfare facility projects funded by the lotteries fund. This item will run till 4:25 or rather 4:30 so that we can have a 55-minute discussion on the item. We have with us Under Secretary for Labour and Welfare, Mr. Ho Kai-ming, and his two colleagues. Once again, this is an item on annual briefing on welfare facility projects funded by the Lotteries Fund. It's a standing item. We discuss it every year. Mr. Ho Kai-ming will brief us on this item. Meanwhile, members, if you want to speak, please press the button while he does so. I'm going to draw a line in due course. I'll give Mr. Ho the floor. Now, we brief members on the new welfare facility projects which the government plans to seek funding from the Lotteries Fund in 2023 and the latest development of projects reported in the last annual briefing. The government plans to apply for funding with the Lotteries Fund for 46 new welfare facility projects. Details are set out in Annex 1. 33 are public housing development projects, all of which are planned in response to the initiative announced by the government in 2020 to reserve premises equivalent to about 5% of the total GFA in public housing development projects for welfare uses. For the remaining 13 projects, 4 are private housing development projects, 2 are URA development projects, and 7 are projects under the special sites scheme, that is special scheme on privately owned sites for welfare uses. So that's special sites scheme in short. These projects provide rehabilitation and elderly services, etc. It is expected that 21 RCHEs for 18 other centres we provided together with 30 RCHDs and also 4 childcare centres for children with special needs and also other facilities for children such as training centres. At the meeting of the 4th of April, the government reported to members the latest development of the projects under Lotteries Fund. Details are provided in Annex 4, 61 RCHEs and 18 elderly centres, 18 centres for 19 for RCHDs, and integrated vocational rehabilitation services centres, early training centres, on-site or OPRS offices will be provided. The government will follow up on these projects for early implementation of these welfare facilities. Thank you. I see that members are quite hesitant in whether to speak on this item. Let me read out the names. We have 4 members waiting: Dr. Teck Chi-yuen, Ms. Doreen Kong, Dr. David Lam, and then the 4th member to speak. That's me. I'll give each member 5 minutes. Meanwhile, if you wish to speak, don't hesitate. Please press the button to indicate so. In passing, let me also say that if you have other official duties, say if you are the member of the executive committee or director of the NGOs concerned, please consider making a declaration. If there is an interest involved with any of the projects mentioned here, Dr. Teck. Thank you, Chairman. The government is committed to provide welfare facilities. We're always short of sites for welfare facilities. I see $12 billion set aside for the purpose. Now I see a breakthrough. First, we encourage the use of privately owned sites for welfare uses. As the Undersecretary explained, 5% of total GFA in public housing developments will be reserved for welfare uses. There are also other projects, taken by private developers. Well, this is apparently the latest development trend, and a lot of similar projects will be coming on stream to make a breakthrough. Now, with so many more sites available, is there a comprehensive plan, or do you still take a piecemeal approach? In the old days, the government would discuss with the welfare sector about a five-year plan. That's planning for the provision of facilities in the coming 5 years. Is it possible to tell members, say, in the coming 5 years, how many sites will be supplied? And how will the sites be used? And what is your plan? Because my next question will be whether the lottery's fund will have sufficient reserve to support your projects. To answer the members' question, we abide by the requirements in the Hong Kong Planning Standards and Guidelines in the provision of facilities. In new towns and new development areas, it's easier. Say we have new developments, and in the new public housing developments, for example, it will be easier for us to meet the Hong Kong PSG. It's rather more difficult for older built-up districts. But in general, we also have regard to manpower projections in different districts. Now, Dr. Tick asked whether it is whether we keep a set of statistics on this matter. Let me just say that basically we plan for the facilities in line with the requirements in the Hong Kong PSG and population projection. I'll defer to my colleague. Yes, as the Undersecretary said, we do give regard to the Hong Kong PSG and the development needs in the district. In the coming 5 years, most of the sites in supply will come from public housing developments in new areas such as Tuen Mun. In the larger public housing development, more facilities will be provided, such as childcare centres and elderly centres. Because the district, if the district is bigger with a larger population, we can accommodate more facilities. Now, in built-up old districts, say for the Hong Kong Housing Society and HA redevelopment projects such as Wafu Estate, upon redevelopment, we will be able to provide some facilities as well. Thank you. I just want to say that we now make breakthroughs in identifying sites for the provision of welfare facilities. I just want you to map out the supply of sites in the coming 5 years. My next question is whether, with so many sites being made available, whether the lottery's funds can cope with the development projects. We have fiscal prudence when it comes to managing these projects. New projects will only be kickstarted if we have sufficient reserve in the lottery's fund, so we are confident that they can be completed. Well, what about having too many sites but not enough money? In other words, you won't be able to have sufficient funding for the new projects on the new sites? The answer is no. Some of the projects will be funded by the Capital Works Reserve Fund. For example, for the facilities costing fewer than $50 million, this will be funded by the lottery's fund. Ms. Doreen Kong. Thank you, Chairman. In the list of new projects planned, I am happy to see that a lot of welfare facilities will be provided. But my concern is that we provide a welfare facility whenever we come across a new site. Now, I declare that I'm a I'm a staff for the MTRCL. We also have the similar projects. My concern is this. In some areas, say in Tongchong, there are 7 such projects, Shangshou, 4 projects, Fanling, 6 projects, Yunlong, 8 projects. Because these are newer development areas, there are newer developments to accommodate new welfare facilities. Now, I'd like to pick up on what Dr. Tick said. Are we providing facilities based on the demand per district, or are we just trying to cram in as many facilities as possible? Say, in older districts such as Kowloon, it's more difficult to provide new welfare facilities. The situation is even more serious in Hong Kong Island. Now, after the meeting, will you be able to give us a table, say, in the coming 5 years, in terms of residential care homes for the elderly, for the disabled, childcare centers, so on and so forth? Is there a planning for these facilities per district, so that we have a clear idea whether these facilities are in shortage or in surplus in different districts? Another question is this. In these 2 tables, altogether I see close to 100 projects. As far as the hardware is concerned, I'm just worried whether we are wasting the resources. If you have an RCG for just 100 places, you would need to at least provide a kitchen. Is that right? So these are auxiliary facilities. And then 61 RCGs. Do you have sufficient manpower to operate the RCGs? There is already a prevailing manpower squeeze in Hong Kong, in elderly homes. So after you complete these projects, you need to make sure there is sufficient manpower to run them. Another question is this. In Beijing, through the Home Affairs Administration, members of the public can use the app developed by the administration to pick an elderly home out of the 400 registered with the app. So my question is whether you have a one-stop portal for all the RCGs in Hong Kong.
Chair, perhaps I'll respond to the last question first. The Social Welfare Department already has a one-stop service providing information on subsidized places for residential care homes. And on hardware, we are currently in the process of applying for funding. We may only get the funding by 2028 to 2029. So even though all 100 projects are for elderly services, we are talking about 10,000 places. Since we have an aging population, we'll be able to catch up with the demand. And in terms of manpower, we are looking into that. And we are also looking into attracting foreign workers to come and work in our elderly care sector. And are we building these facilities just because we have sites available? Well, we need to adhere to the Hong Kong planning standards and guidelines. We need to identify the suitable sites in respective districts to answer to the demand. Thank you. Next, Dr. David Lam. I have a similar questions. There are many residential care homes for mentally handicapped people and for elderly. I would like to ask whether there is a demand across the territory, or is it up to the organization to decide what purpose it will serve? Second, are there any standard operating hours? Well, for elderly people living with their children, they may need longer hours of care because their children may be out at work. Because for most elderly centers, it seems that they close quite early, and it is very difficult to release employment potential of their children if they can only provide half-day care. Undersecretary, on the operating hours of the facilities, let's say kindergarten, should they be operated full-time over the daycare, elderly daycare center, should they be open for the full day? We have to look into that because it may require longer service hours for staff, let's say physiotherapists, etc. I'll invite my colleague to answer the first question. In the Hong Kong Planning Standards and Guidelines are set out for welfare facilities. For each 25,000 people, there needs to be 100 place service places. And for youth services center, for each 12,000, for elderly people, for each 1,000 people, there needs to be 17.2 service places for people age 65 or above. And for new housing development, we are talking about some 10,000 residents there, so there definitely needs to be a elderly facility there. Dr. Lam, any follow-up? No? Ms. Lillian Kwok. Thank you. Well, I also have a similar question. I would like to know, when were the guidelines that you mentioned, when were the guidelines established? Well, they are updated regularly. In 2017, after the publication of the Elderly Services Program Plan, the guidelines have been updated regularly. The reason for my skepticism is that you said that you will look at the overall population ratio, but actually we are talking about the demand of individual districts, not calculated by population. Let's say the site on Anderson Road. It mainly serves younger elderly people, so they have better skills to take care of themselves. For older districts like in Shunli, there are already many elderly centers, but I believe that they need more daycare centers. But there are only 40 service places. Is that enough to cater for the whole estate? For how many people will you allocate one service place for daycare center? And in the Kwai Chung Shetley public housing development, within 10-minute walking distance, there are already 10 elderly residential care homes. But there are no daycare centers at all. So I'm very skeptical when I heard you said that you had an overall plan. So I would like to hear your thoughts on this and whether there will be any adjustments after hearing our views. Chair. The overall principle is that for newer development sites, since there are sites available, then we are going ahead with these projects. I'm not familiar with the Kaichung district. Perhaps they are private RCHE. But we'll be looking at the district as a whole. For Ontai Estate, Shunlei Estate, etc., they are actually in the vicinity of each other. So are we dividing them into two districts? For each district, we arrange service places for the number of people or number of residents there. For estates with more elderly people, let's say Shunlei Estate, I understand that the elderly people there may not be willing to even leave the area of the estate. We need to follow up on this because I was a district councillor there for many years. I understand their concern, but it is very difficult for us to meet their needs of not even leaving their estates. This may not be feasible. For every 1,000 people age 65 or above, there will be 17.2 places for elderly daycare center. Some of them are attached to RCHE. So for a RCHE with 150 places, there may be 30 places for daycare center. Like I said, for newer development areas, there may be sites available to increase the provision of such facilities. If not, then we'll look into redevelopment project to see how we can increase the number of service places. Thank you. Follow up, please. Resources are limited, and I hope that resources are utilized well, and that they actually can answer to people's needs. At this moment, there may be higher demand for daycare center, but in the future, the demand may change. Maybe we need more RCHEs by then. I hope that you can adapt to the situation. And just then you said for every 1,000 people age 65 or above, you will arrange 17.5 service places. Can you give us the existing information or numbers of 18 districts? Can you provide us with this detail after the meeting so that we can talk about extra measures for aging in place in the future? Thank you. Now it's my turn. But before I ask my question, I would like to ask whether there are any more members wishing to speak. If yes, then please press the button. Undersecretary, a few questions. In our discussion, we said that there are more available sites in new development area, let's say in Tongchong, Northern Metropolis, Sunshou, Yunlong, etc. Is it possible for the Social Welfare Department or the Lotteries Fund to acquire existing land from private developers? Let's say someone would like to donate a piece of land to build a RCHE. Then will the lottery's fund sponsor the construction of such a building? Some scholars have suggested the idea of a elderly village in the Greater Bay Area. Is it possible to allocate resources to the Greater Bay Area to establish elderly care facilities using Hong Kong standards? For example, the two projects in Yantian and Xiaoqing, is it possible to take a step further from that? If someone is willing to donate a piece of land, will the government consider sponsoring the construction of such facilities?
Next, about the special sites scheme, Dr. Chi-yuen sang praises about this new scheme. That was the time when I first joined this council. It's been 10 years already. When exactly will the NGOs be able to complete the projects? Not so much completion of the projects, but at least make some progress. Let me take the second question, because I also followed up personally on some of the cases. I understand that the director is following up on other special sites or projects under the special site scheme. We need to follow the established procedures, but it has more to do with the project operators' considerations. Despite having funding support from us, the operator may have different thoughts on, say, the provision of certain places. And these places, according to our current policies, have been scrapped. And that is why they are withdrawing the progress, withdrawing the project. And as a result, the general progress has been slow. We will, of course, follow up closely on the projects, but I'm afraid we can't tell you all the details at this moment. Members, if you have other proposals, and if you have heard of other proposals, do approach us. Say the former LegCo member, the audit commissioner, actually, or the director of audit, actually put forward a proposal on an organization's behalf, and we've taken it on board. So this will be useful to answer the other question, whether it is possible to build homes in the in the Greater Bay Area. We're going to expand the care home scheme in Guangdong. We will roll out the plan in the second half of this year. That means residential care homes in Guangdong province will be collaborating with NGOs in Hong Kong. After going through the scam, that is standard assessment for elderly services, they will be able to receive subsidies. We are in the process of assessing the projects to see if they meet the requirements, because instead of going by the board place scheme, we use the voucher scheme, and they will need to recruit sufficient elderly people for it to work. For the private homes, well, because the services are only confined to residents in Hong Kong, the progress is therefore slow. Meanwhile, we will continue to visit the mainland to check the other facilities. For example, last month, I checked out the facility in Yantian, Shenzhen, as well as other facilities. With the deputy mayor in Shenzhen, we maintain liaison. And next month, we will also invite other NGOs to visit Guangdong province to check out their facilities, and we'll report to LegCo members in due course. I'm sorry, it seems that you are telling us something new. This is also something close to my heart, but you haven't answered my question. The question is whether there is room for the lottery's fund to provide assistance, actual assistance, for organizations to build new rehabilitation facilities in the mainland. Well, of course, the Hong Kong government will provide every assistance it can, but the current situation is that often these homes have been built, and then some elderly organizations or NGOs will be tasked to take over the operation of these homes. And this will provide an option for elderly in Hong Kong to decide whether to live there. It's not the case as in Hong Kong that they just surrender a site for the Hong Kong government to build a new home. Anyway, I will bring your view back and give it a thought. Second round, two members would like to speak again. What about other members here? Anyone want to go for another round? Another question for members. Do we agree that after these two members have spoken, we will adjourn this meeting? Dr. Tik Chi-yuen and Ms. Lillian KWOK, 4 minutes each. Thank you, Chairman. Well, we discuss at length planning matters and resource allocation. Frankly, as a Legislative Council member, I'm not sure what sites will be made available, what facilities will be commissioned in the coming 5 years. It seems that we are kept in the dark. So I'd like the government to tell me in the coming 5 years, just present this information in whatever way you want. Tell me, say, what sites will be made available under the special sites scheme. And for the 5% GFA reserved for public housing development, usually this happens in the new territories. But for special sites scheme, this could happen in Hong Kong and Kowloon as well. So first of all, let us know through different means what sites are available in the coming 5 years. And then what criteria you adopt in according the use of these sites to be made available in the coming 5 years. The next question is, as Chairman said, in the Greater Bay Area, will we be able to provide welfare facilities such as RCHEs and RCHDs which abide by Hong Kong standards for use by Hong Kong residents? I hope that a meeting can be convened as quickly as possible. A public hearing should be conducted. There are strong calls in the community for these facilities to be provided. This will, of course, provide a boost to the provision of welfare facilities in Hong Kong. It seems that the chief executive shares the same view as well. So perhaps we should all put our heads together. You should listen to the views of the community so that you can expedite your work as quickly as possible. We don't need to have tea elsewhere. We can have tea here. Our tea is nice. Yes, we can have tea in the antechamber as well. We have high transparency. For example, earlier we met with the mayor of Shenzhen and also other work progress. We make all information available. But there are other things to consider, such as other supporting service. Healthcare is one of them. So we need to continue to engage in discussions. And the director will be leading a delegation with NGOs to visit the mainland again. Following what is set out in the policy address by the end of this year, we will strive to make more information available. It seems that we don't have much time left, so please give me a written reply. Dr. Tik, anything to add? Ms. Lillian KWOK. Thank you, Chair. Oh, this just sprung up in my mind. For example, at the moment, there is a need for daycare centers. But 10 years down the road, is it possible to convert one of the floors into an RCHE? Is it possible? Ms. KWOK, do you have other questions? Just ask all the questions in one go. This is about another area, about the general policy direction of the government. You support the principle of aging in the community, so there should be more support for community-based care. I mentioned daycare centers and daycare units. This is one way of supporting aging in place. I mentioned earlier that we have just so many quotas or so many places for daycare centers. So there are limitations. I don't have the exact figures at hand, but in your new projects, are you going to provide facilities to support aging in place and community-based care for the elderly? Now, next question, apart from the existing mode of services and facilities, will you consider new directions such as new modes of childcare and support centers for caregivers and integrated service centers, so on and so forth, so that these new ideas can be incorporated in your plan and that you will be able to provide a greater diversity of services in the future? I'll defer to my colleague to take the question on planning for facilities. As for existing facilities, is it possible to convert an existing daycare center into an RCHE? We need to, of course, have regard to the structure of the premises. Now, if you have an RCHE in the area, it means there is a higher proportion of elderly. If you take a look at the annex, in some areas, we may provide, say, the outreach community-based or home care teams for the frail, because if in the area the proportion of frail elders are higher. We have an aging population in Hong Kong. We should strive to provide more facilities for the elderly. Instead of converting facilities from one to another, we should strive to meet the demand for elderly services as a whole. I'll defer to my colleague to take the other question. We consider the overall demand, the location of the facilities, the accessibility in planning for facilities. For example, for daycare centers, we need to make sure that parking or picking up, dropping off areas will be made available because it takes longer for an elderly passenger to get off the vehicle. Now, for RCHEs, there is a very stringent mechanism in approving licenses. We need to consider, for example, the headroom and clearance on each floor, the ventilation requirement, whether there are windows. Relatively speaking, the requirements are not as stringent for daycare centers. So, if we are to convert an RCHE or daycare center into an RCHE, we may not be able to install beds because there may be windowless rooms. It may be more possible to convert an RCHE into a daycare center. So, a point of clarification, Chairman, if the basic requirements and the setting as a whole can be met, say if the headroom clearance is 2.4 meters, that means the requirements can be met. It is possible for the facility to be converted to something else. Right, but we also need to have regard to the land lease. Not so much for a government site, but say for a private developer site. If earlier it was stipulated that the site should be used for a daycare center, and if there is no longer a demand for a daycare center, then land lease modification will be required. That's the case for a government site as well as a private site under the special site scheme. Say, if the site if it is stipulated in the land lease that an RCE should be built, then technically you need to undergo modification works if you are to convert it into a daycare center. It is technically feasible, only that it will take time.
Regarding this item, I believe that all members have asked their question. This item does not need to be submitted to the PWSC. I will try to conclude or summarize the item. For the current term and the coming 2 years and the coming 5 years, can you provide us with a breakdown of the facilities by districts so that members will so that it will be easier for members to follow up? And please provide us with more details using various means, such as doing LASHCO meetings or conducting field trips to the mainland. I hope that the Undersecretary can relate our comments to the administration. Excuse me, Chair. Just then, I requested the current ratio of the population, the ratio of the service places to the overall population. Can you give us the details by districts? And just then you said that for every 25,000 people, there needs to have 100 service place for RCHE and for youth center as well. Can you give us the breakdown? Well, actually, this is public information, but I believe that the SWD can consolidate the details for us. So that members can have a better understanding of the figures. If you have other requests, you can find out more information through other means, members. Chair? How about the future land supply in the coming 5 years? Is it possible for the administration to provide details for us? Well, I'm sorry, perhaps you have misunderstood me. That part is included as well. Okay, so that concludes this agenda item. Next item, AOB. There is none. Meeting adjourned. Thank you.